we listen to our first hymn.
Romans chapter 14, beginning at the first verse. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honour of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honour of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honour of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, Not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves, who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, Pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, Have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in his anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he should pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. If you were here last week, you will recall that our gospel passage dealt with conflicts in God's family, the church, and gave us a practical method for resolving it. Together, we considered a step-by-step process given to us by Jesus as a practical way to achieve peaceful resolution. Today's gospel continues that theme of conflict resolution. This time, Jesus addresses directly the issue of forgiveness. I'll go ahead and give away the ending by telling you that what Jesus expects of us is that both our apologies and our forgiveness be total and genuine. So I can convince you that that's right, let's dive into the text with Peter. As our gospel reading begins, Jesus has just outlined what one should do if one is sinned against. Peter, as always, is full of questions, and he says to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? And Peter gives what he thinks is a thoroughly reasonable answer, 7 times. He suggests what he thinks is realistic. Jesus upturns Peter's reasonable expectations, and he says to him, No, don't forgive 7 times, forgive 77 times. Now, I don't know about you, but my experience of forgiveness is that it entails vulnerability and a great deal of patience. I have to be prepared to accept that the person who's asking for forgiveness is genuine, that they don't intend to hurt me again. If someone came to you and asked for forgiveness once, you'd be willing to give it, I reckon. What happened if they came to you having hurt you again in the same way? You might be hesitant, but willing. What if the third time came round? Your patience, perhaps, might be wearing a little thin. And if you're anything like me, by the time you got to seven times, your desire to be loving and vulnerable might be tested. Yet Jesus says to Peter, you have to be ready to be vulnerable, loving and patient on 77 occasions with the same person. Notice that 7 and 77 are not arbitrary numbers. In Scripture, 7 is a number that symbolizes perfection. For in 6 days God made the world, and on the 7th day he rested. It stands for completeness, unity, and godliness. 77 is a multiplication, an expansion of the number 7. Therefore, it is a multiplication and expansion of goodness and godliness and perfection. Jesus says that those who are members of his family should abound in godliness and goodness. In other words, when we forgive, we should really mean it. To emphasize this point, Jesus tells a parable. There was a king, and he wanted to settle accounts with his slaves. He went and he got the books, and he found that one of them owed him 10,000 talents. Now that doesn't mean a lot to me, but I looked into it, and a talent was worth about 15 years' wages of an ordinary laborer. So, if you've done maths in your head, as I did, if I got it right, what we see before us is someone who owes 150,000 years' worth of salary. The king brings this slave before him, and knowing the enormity of his debt, orders that he be sold into slavery, along with his wife and children, that all his possessions be sold, and that payment be made as it could be. The slave, naturally, is distressed, and he falls on his knees and begs the king, have patience with me, and I'll pay you everything. The king feels pity. He releases the slave, and he forgives the debt. The king, of his bounty, of his own largesse, forgives 150,000 years worth of salary. That's an amount that never could have been paid. Now, this same slave, who's just been forgiven this debt, walks out of the king's throne room and encounters a fellow slave. This man owes him 100 denarii. Now, a denarius was about a day's wage for a laborer. So the slave who's just been forgiven this enormous debt is owed a relatively modest sum of 100 days' wages. Surely, between the two of them, they can come to some kind of sensible agreement for repayment. The slave who owes 100 denarii says, have patience with me, and I will pay you. He says to his fellow slave exactly what that slave just a few moments before has said to the king. Have patience with me and I will pay you. But what's the response? A refusal. Furthermore, the slave who owes only a little is thrown into prison until he should pay the debt. Rather difficult, isn't it, to pay a debt if you can't work? Now, this incident is observed. There are other slaves about in the king's palace. Jesus describes them as being greatly distressed. Just imagine how you would feel if you saw one of your friends send someone to prison for a small debt when you know they've just been forgiven a huge debt, a debt that could never be repaid. A I think greatly distressed might be an understatement. I would be furious, completely and utterly astounded, and enraged at the injustice, the unfairness of it. I would be profoundly disturbed that the one who had been forgiven much didn't seem to appreciate at all what had been done for him. So, the slaves who are distressed and angry go to the king. They tell him what they've seen. There's no need to exaggerate it. It's an extraordinary example of callousness, small-mindedness, and meanness. So the king sends for the slave. He says to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? What have you to say for yourself, you ungrateful fool?" Imagine it, can't we? "I forgave you a debt of millions, billions even. Yet you refuse to forgive a debt that could easily be repaid. How dare you take advantage of my generosity?" And in his anger, the king handed the slave over to be tortured until he should pay his entire debt. It is impossible, of course, to pay a debt while one is being tortured. There is perhaps a somewhat pleasing symmetry for us as we hear this story. The one who was not generous to his fellow slave is treated to a punishment that surpasses the punishment he meted out on his equal. We might feel a bit smug as readers, mightn't we? But what does Jesus say? Does he say that the king eventually relented? Does he say the king thought again and had mercy? No. Jesus says, "So my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart." Feel the smugness evaporate. What will the Heavenly Father do to us if we fail to forgive? He'll hand us over to be tortured until we pay the debt that we owe, which we can never do. How does that make you feel? That's a genuine question, if anyone's brave enough to answer it. How does that make you feel? Shall I just look at your expressions and gather? Well, Peter asked a very reasonable question, didn't he? How many times should I forgive? He got an answer he probably didn't expect. Because the parable is about God's generosity to us. How much has God forgiven you? Has he forgiven the sins you committed in your youth? Has he forgiven the sins you committed yesterday? I've got a list in the back of my head as I'm asking you that question. I know what I did yesterday. You don't need to know. Well, we know that we are forgiven if we believe that Jesus died for our sins. We are forgiven if we trust in his blood to cover our debt. So, if we know ourselves to be forgiven by God for all the things that we've ever done wrong, all the sins we've committed, all the thoughts we shouldn't have had, all the words we shouldn't have spoken, all the deeds we should not have done, if we know the absolute enormity of what God has forgiven us, ought we to have the same measure of charity towards our fellow servants? When you really know what God's forgiveness means, forgiving others 77 times is not too much to ask. Do you believe and trust in God, the Father who made the world?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ, who saved mankind?
I believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit who gives life to the people of God?
I believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please sit as we pray together.
We pray for justice, mutual respect, peace and humility. We pray for our political leaders, both locally and nationally, as they have to make so many life and death decisions to try and keep us all safe during the COVID pandemic. Lord our God, let your will be done in us. We pray for our families and those who make us feel happy and comfortable, and also for those who we find it hard to get on with. We pray for all who take care of children in family and educational settings. Help them to guide and care for those children as they grow up to become the community of tomorrow. Lord our God,
let your will be done in us.
We pray for those whose minds and bodies are trapped in illness, those who lack freedom of movement, and at this time those suffering from COVID and its after effects. We pray for all involved in medical research and for all doctors, nurses and care support staff, that they may stay safe themselves and continue to care for all the sick and suffering. We pray in particular for those who ask for our prayers at this time. Ruth White, Eileen Halifax, Leslie Boothman, Margaret Rose, Jeff Smith, Reverend Paul Hardiman, Carol Hudson, and Evie. Lord our God, let your will be done in us. We pray for the departed and the dying, particularly those dying without care or comfort, and for all victims of violence. We remember the souls of the departed and their families, and friends suffering with the pain and loss of a loved one. We pray in particular for the families and friends and for the souls of Jane Hill, Nancy Kinnersley, Nancy K. Wilson, William Thorold, Stanley E. Craft, Jim Morbell, Clifford Howell Exton, Florence Ann Seymour, Alan Pearson, Eric Lawson, Mary Exton, Harold Darling, John Robert Rose, Burton Bennett, Edith Alice Lumby, Charles Cobb, Cyril Albert Vela. Lord our God, let your will be done in us. We pray for a deeper understanding of God as we remember the thankfulness, the constant faithfulness and love which surrounds us. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We please stand for peace. As those who have been forgiven much, let us share with one another a sign of peace. peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And we sit as we listen to our offertory hymn. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As as we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ and our hearts in the Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Lord God, the source of truth and love, keep us faithful to the Apostles' teaching and fellowship, united in prayer and the breaking of bread, and one in joy and simplicity of heart, in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God,
we thank you for feeding us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. The living of our souls and bodies, to be a living sacrifice, send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
We please stand as we enjoy our common gift. Peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
For those of you who don't recognise me, there is a silhouette of me on the back of your notices, resplendent in my cycling gear. So yeah, David took part in the sponsored cycle ride yesterday. So many thanks to those of you that did sponsor me. I think the figure at the moment is around about £200, half of which stays with this church and half goes to Lincolnshire Trust. We had a fantastic day. Thanks to Elizabeth, I think she's disappeared now, for arranging the hymns that we sang. And to Sheila, where's Sheila? Give us away, Sheila. But I think I expended more energy singing 16 hymns than possibly the 16 miles that we cycled. But it was a fantastic day. We were blessed with lovely weather as we got today. So many thanks to you all. If you haven't sponsored me already, there's still time. There are some forms at the back, or just give your money to Julie. Okay, many thanks. Bye-bye.